So if you're live here with us, we are welcoming our guest and doing a little bit of housekeeping, going over some technical things. As you know, each session is being recorded. And last week, Dr. Wasserman joined us and we didn't get to share slides, but we will load his slides on our website and convert them to a PDF. So many people have already emailed and said, hey, can I get that presentation? Wasn't it great if you were able to join him and the rest of us last week? This week, we have such a privilege of having an esteemed colleague from Johns Hopkins. So as we are unfolding more programs throughout the year, this is our last Tuesday in February, fortunately. But as you know, beginning in January, we started co-hosting a hybrid program with virtual audience and a live audience. So someone's saying it's very hard to hear. All right. How's that, Miss Pauline? All right. Yeah, you got to use the chat, okay? Thank you. Okay, it is the top of the hour. We love to start on time and end early, right? So kudos to each of you who came on site. This is a great space for us to host this program. In front of you, if you're in our live audience, you have a note card. If you want to split it in half, if you think you're going to have more than one or two questions, but that's how we're going to manage our questions for our live audience here. If you're at home tuning in, I see how many people are with us. Last week, we had 267 virtual members. That grows over the course of the hour. So we're so grateful for the virtual audience, literally joining us from all over the world. Last week, I asked you where you were tuning in from, many from Atlanta, but Iowa, somewhere from Africa, literally Brazil. Yes. So isn't it awesome to have just people joining us who believe in our mission to ultimately find a cure for memory impairment? With that said, as you know, we begin each program with exercise, right? We like to practice what we preach, and what's good for your heart is good for your brain. And so every week since March of 2020, we've been hosting the 60-minute program where we're trying to keep our older adults and caregivers informed. We want you aging well. We want you growing well, but we also want you to be healthy and keep what you have, right? So who here, raised by a raise of hand, has benefited from all of this great information for the last several years? Wonderful. Mm-hmm. Have you implemented anything you've learned? Yes. So our virtual audience, you can type in the chat if you want to tell us, hey, I've improved my exercise. I'm adding a sleep journal, perhaps, or I'm doing some strategies to improve my memory over time. But whatever you're doing, do something. You don't have to do all 10 of the things we recommend over time, but pick one or two things that you are going to be committed to. Okay. And I think that's all the housekeeping, the scrolling slides were going. We have a lot going on. In 3 weeks, we're hosting a national program in concert with Florida International around dementia disparities. I know when Dr. Parker comes up, she can give you a little bit more detail about that, as well as our upcoming 24th Brain Health Forum. It will not be hybrid. So the registration is open. If you want to come to the Carter Center, you better register. The lineup is phenomenal as well. It's going to be a really short program from 10 to 1. The doors open at 10. Program starts at 10:30, and we're going to get you out by 1. Okay. Anything else? All right, so we're turning it over to John. You go at your own pace. I want everyone moving at your own pace. The chairs in here have wheels, but make sure at home you have a sturdy chair, right? And then after John, you're going to hear from Dr. Parker, and then she's going to turn it over to Dr. Marsh. All right, thank you guys for joining us. Have a great rest of the time this hour. Make sure you take lots of notes, right? Because we cover a lot of information in a short amount of time. Welcome, John.
Yes, yes. I want to say welcome. And first of all, I want to say to those people that I see on virtual and you get to see me live, it's a pleasure meeting you as well. And everybody around the city that recognized me, I want to say thank you. So we're going to get ready to go. Remember, at your own risk, if you need to take a break, take it and make sure you get back in. Let's go. Let me know. I don't know when until it comes on. So. We're gonna warm it up. We're gonna warm that waist up. Let's go. We're getting that waistline. There we go. Boom. This ab season now. We gotta get ready for June. Let's go. Come on. There we go. Right here in the waistline. We're creating that circulation. Let's go. Other way. Right here. I mean, y'all had that much space. We getting those lats. Watch it now. I'm putting a little crunch in right now. Come on. Come on. Come on. Watch it now. I just need you to lean forward. We're saying back. Let's get ready. Roll it. There we go. Watch it now. Here we go. Boom. Boom. We're getting those shoulders, but we also getting that waistline. And great job. All right. I want you to know that I feel the room. I don't have a certain selection of music. I feel the room and then I get the groove and then. Look at that show. Come on. Come on. Hey. Come on now. Oh, y'all feeling it now. Oh, y'all looking good. Y'all looking good. Watch this now. Oh. Come on. Come on. Come on. Watch this now. Get it. Double time. Get it. There we go. Come on. Come on, break it that down. Come on, we're gonna keep twisting. Woo! Come on now, feel the groove. Watch it, watch it, watch it, watch it, and switch. Come on, come on, and switch. Watch this now. Oh. Come on. Get, why can't y'all get this one? Woo! Loosen up! Loosen up! And great job! Y'all looking real sexy here today. Men, y'all looking very good today. Let's get these arms. Come on. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it.
Yeah.
Let's go. Come on. Come on. Good shoulders. Good chest. Good lats. Watch it. Boom. Good outer chest. Good shoulders. Let's go. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Break it down. Break it down. Boom. Good lats. Good back. Good lats. Good back. Let's go. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Good biceps. There you go. Come on. Come on. Come on. Watch it now. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Good lats. Good outer chest. Get it. Get it. Get it. Get it. Get it. Get it. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Go. Roll it. Roll it. Roll it. Roll it. Good shoulders. Come on. Come on. Come on. Add that waist in a little bit. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Oh. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Go. 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 Boom. Go. 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 go, break it down, oh, watch it, go, hey, can y'all grab that waist back in, hey, rest, there we go. We're going to slow it down a little bit. Real technical. We got to, I'm going to slide that back in this chair a little bit. Here we go. We're going to get these lower abs. It's ab season. Here we go. Now crunch. Rest. Go. Boom. Crunch. Come on now. Grab them now. That's your leg. Boom. Rest. Now we're going to get these side obliques right here. Here we go. Come on now. This other side. Oh, come on. Come on now. Rest. I need you on them toes, legs together. Now we get those side obliques. Come on now. Watch this. Come on. Get it. Woo.
What am I supposed to say?
Come on now.
Bend down.
Come on. Come on. Watch it now. Watch it. Watch it. Watch it. And come on. Y'all looking good. Let's go. Come on. I'm getting those hips. We're getting those cardio. We're getting that cardio up right now. Come on now. Come on. We're going to work those legs. Come on. Come on. Come on. Watch it now. See you later. Bye.
It is my pleasure this afternoon to introduce you to Dr. Marsh. Dr. Marsh is a board-certified vascular neurologist whose research involves post-stroke recovery and post-stroke cognitive impairment, like how your brain works. Okay? She is currently an associate professor of neurology at the Johns Hopkins School of Medicine within the cerebrovascular division. So Dr. Marsh is the medical director of the stroke program at Johns Hopkins Bayview Medical Center, and she implemented the Bayview Stroke Intervention Clinic, which is a follow-up clinic designed to promote patient follow-up, decreased hospital readmission rates, and improve post-stroke recovery. Her focus at present is on the underreported neurologic deficits that occur after a stroke, namely things like depression, things like fatigue, and cognition that occur to people who've suffered from strokes. So a lot of times what we think of as a good recovery from stroke in a medical center may not be what families think of as a good recovery. So at this time, I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Marsh from Johns Hopkins. Dr. Marsh.
Thank you. It's such a pleasure to be here. Can everybody hear me okay?
We can see and hear you.
Perfect. Fantastic. Well, I was having fun too. I had my camera off because my children tell me I have no rhythm. So my apologies, but I was at my desk and I do feel I also have a ways to go before beach season. But I'm so happy to be here today talking with all of you about something that's really important to me, and that's cognition. I do want to start by talking a little bit about stroke because brain health overall and stroke can have a huge impact on your cognition, and it's much better to prevent it than have to deal with it later. But then I want to tell you what some of our studies have taught us about some potential treatments for cognitive impairment and difficulty thinking, regardless of the reason, and how some of our research has kind of helped to inform some things. Can't wait to take your questions. So I'll go ahead and get started and we'll see what you're most interested in hearing more about. Okay, let's see. There we go. Just a couple of things. Thank you for the wonderful introduction. It's true, my lab does investigate post-stroke cognition, and I'm fortunate enough to be supported by the American Heart Association and the NIH, and then grateful patients and their families. And that really allows us to do the work that we do. And my goal is ultimately to keep patients and their families healthier and living better quality lives after their strokes. So today I want to talk a little bit, but I want to set the stage by talking about stroke recovery, which I know you guys, most of you, that's not necessarily where you're coming from when you're thinking about preventing problems with your cognition or treating them, but I think it sets the stage. And hopefully most of you won't have to deal with stroke with you or your loved ones, but it's also important to know some of the things that we've been up to as far as advancing treatments and rehab, and then talk about how we've been able to learn from that a lot about cognition and about thinking and about potential strategies to help that we may be able to apply to other areas and benefit people like yourselves. So I don't think I have to convince any of you, but I'm going to make my pitch anyway, that stroke is a big deal. It's common and really debilitating. There's 800,000 every year in the United States. We are super excited that we have moved to the fifth leading cause of death. We keep falling, which is awesome because people are taking better care of themselves, which is great, but it's still the leading cause of long-term morbidity. So just because you survive from a stroke doesn't mean that you aren't severely affected. And like was said earlier, sometimes that might be physical and sometimes it may be other things like depression or fatigue or thinking problems. And that results in a lot of lost healthcare dollars and a lot of medical expenditures and lost wages that can be a big problem. And why is this the case? Well, you guys know it's because major risk factors for stroke are really common, right? Blood pressure, diabetes, cholesterol, smoking, atrial fibrillation, which as we get older, that's when the heart doesn't beat nice and regular, but it kind of goes boom, 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 boom. You've probably seen those commercials on TV. Well, it significantly increases your risk for stroke. The great thing is, and if I can put out a plug, managing these risk factors and doing it from the time you're middle-aged, like myself, I can't believe I have to say that, but and all throughout is going to significantly help to decrease your risk of stroke and keep your brain as healthy as it can be. And that's going to be the best way to help prevent getting dementia and getting cognitive impairment. So there are exciting things. So God forbid when people do have strokes, there are things we can do now. We've made a lot of progress. And I also want to let this group know, because it's important that you recognize the symptoms of stroke early, because you can be treated. So around 1995, the first treatment for ischemic stroke, so the blockage of a blood vessel that causes that territory in the brain to die, was FDA approved. And this medication that we use is called TPA, tissue plasminogen activator. And what it is you know, when your sink gets clogged and you pour Drano into the sink, that's kind of what TPA does. You put it into the vein and it goes to the blood vessel where the clot is, and it helps to break it up. And it had significant ramifications to treating people and to helping them get better. People that came in and couldn't move their arm, all of a sudden that blood vessel's open and they're getting better and they're moving better. It was a huge game changer at stroke. But the problem is you can only give this medicine in the first couple of hours. So you have to recognize the symptoms right away and get to the hospital so that you're a candidate for this medicine. But we've gotten even better, which is really exciting to me. And in 2015, it took us 20 years, yeah. But in 2015, we developed a new therapy called mechanical thrombectomy. And that's kind of like when someone has a heart attack and they take a catheter to treat it and they put it in your groin and snake it all the way up to your heart. Well, you can go past the heart and go all the way into the brain and actually remove, just like in this picture here, remove the clot. You kind of deploy the stent. It's kind of like a ship in a bottle, and you can actually shrink it down and it pulls the clot right out. So along with TPA, which helps break up the clot, we could take the stent and pull the clot out and open some of these vessels and make significant progress and get people better. And what that does, so this is a brain MRI, and you see here on the left, this big area of white. This is what a lot of strokes used to look like. All this was dead tissue. And you can imagine when none of this part of your brain is working, you look pretty bad. So you can't move. You can't move your face, your arm, or your leg. You probably are having trouble speaking, might be having trouble with your eye movements, problems with eating and drinking, and oftentimes in a nursing home. And with these treatments, we turn them into these much smaller strokes. Do you see this little white spot right here? This person still has some weakness on one side, but is home and doing well and getting better there, unlike this person who's in a nursing home. So we've made significant improvements for a group of patients, certainly not everybody, but a number of patients are doing much better, which is great and exciting. You're going to say, okay, Liz Marsh, why are you telling me about this? I want to know about cognition. I'm getting there, I promise. We've also, though, in thinking about stroke recovery, made really great advances in how we rehabilitate people. This is where we start to come in and thinking about cognition and about recovery. So at Hopkins, as an example, but this is happening all over the world at Emory and other great places, there's people that are looking at motor recovery. How do I get your arm better faster if it's not working? How do I get your language? That's aphasia is a fancy word for language problems when you can't speak or understand. How do we get those better? And we've made wonderful advancements. So that's getting better too. But cognition has been a poorly recognized problem, right? It's really obvious when someone can't move their side or can't speak, but it's not as obvious when they're having trouble and they're just feeling fuzzy or they're not quite right, right? You used to be at work and in a meeting and now you're just a couple steps behind and aren't keeping track or can't multitask. And that's a big problem for people. We'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. But one of the things I want to tell you guys about first, so you've heard it, is about how we think about stroke, or how we used to think about stroke outcomes. And that's with something called the National Institutes of Health Stroke Scale, or the NIH Stroke Scale. And it's kind of like golf. You get points for things you can't do. So if I can't move my arm, I get points. If I can't talk, I get points. And they add up. So high numbers are bad and low numbers are good. And what we've seen over time is we've been able to take the higher numbers and make them lower numbers. Yay, we're doing a great job, which is awesome. But in my clinic, where I see a lot of patients with stroke, what I noticed was that was great. So happy that we're doing that. But people were coming in with other deficits. I'd say, oh my gosh, you're looking so great. And they'd start to cry. And they'd say, Dr. Marsh, like, that's awesome that you think I'm doing great, but I can't think. like, right? I can't multitask. I'm exhausted and can't stay awake for my grandkids. I can't concentrate. Like, what's going on? Like, I'm glad I can walk and talk, but something isn't right. And we wanted to learn a little bit more about this. So what does not right mean? There's ways we can figure that out. And the first thing we did is we wanted to look at people's thinking. So how do you do that? Because this is going to come into play in just a minute. We use something called the MOCA, which is the Montreal Cognitive Assessment. So it's a tool that lets us see how people are thinking. And you have to do a whole bunch of things. So you have to connect 1 to A, to 2, to B, to 3, to C, and go back and forth. That's hard. That requires thinking. You have to draw this cube. I want you to draw a clock, to name some pictures, to remember some things, to do some math. So this is a really good screen of the thinking pieces. And you know what we found is that people had problems. These small strokes, smart people, relatively young people, weren't doing okay. We wanted to look at that a little bit. So when I say, you know, they weren't doing okay, you said to me, well, what does that mean? And so we actually took over 200 people in our clinic, 214 actually, and we compared them to almost 40 people who had never had a stroke before, but were the same age-ish and had the same risk factors. And we saw them after their stroke. And these were people that had small strokes and bigger strokes versus no strokes. And what we found is, based on that MOCA, people that had any stroke at all had a lot of problems in every piece of that MOCA. Different people were different, but there wasn't one domain that was spared compared to those with no stroke at all. And certainly people with more severe strokes did worse. But even people with those small, mild strokes, small NIH stroke scales that were walking down the street and you'd think they look really good. Wow, you had a stroke. I can't believe it. They weren't thinking well, and they weren't doing okay. We wanted to just know okay, we're seeing this. Great, it's a problem. What might be playing a role? What are the driving factors? How do I know if you're going to have problems with your thinking, right? Because you as a patient want to know that and want to know, why am I likely to have problems? And then what can I do about it? So who's likely to have problems? We looked at a bunch of stuff. We looked at how much education they'd had, how much support they have at home, how big the strokes were. And we found a couple things. So these are MOCA cutoffs. So this is kind of bad mental status. This is really bad mental status. These are just cutoffs for how poorly they did. And what we found is, remember I told you NIH stroke scales, is how severe their symptoms are. So more than a 6 is more severe. Stroke volume size, so bigger than 17 cc's, big stroke. But we also found, and those were certainly important, that people that were employed and that were active and highly functioning prior to their strokes actually did better. So whereas all these other guys, their odds ratio of having lower MOCAs was high, employment prior to stroke, good pre-morbid function was protective. Really important. Baseline function matters. Keeping your brain healthy, being active, being engaged before you have a problem really matters as far as how you're going to do with cognition and that problem. So the next piece, so okay, great. I know who's at risk. Now can we understand why so that we can better inform treatments that will help in stroke and will help other people like yourselves who might not have had strokes? So how do we understand what's going on in the brain and why these little strokes, right? I told you they're small. Why are they causing such big problems with thinking? And the way we get to that is we use something called functional neuroimaging. So it's a fancy way of saying we see what the brain's doing in real time. So this is my research nurse who's wonderful. And this is something called an MEG machine or a MEG. And it's kind of a cross between an MRI and an EEG. And it shows you brain activity in real time. So we do a task on a screen and I can see in your brain, show you here, exactly what's going on and what activity is. So this is just an example. Hold on just a second, you'll see it. This is really slow. So these are milliseconds. So I've slowed it way down, but this person has seen a beam of light and they start by seeing the light in the occipital lobe. And then you're gonna see it go all over the brain. So it's no longer just in the occipital lobe. Now it's spreading and it's going all over the brain because I teach people, the medical students, the residents, that different parts of the brain do different things. But in reality, to think, you need your whole brain, and information has to travel across your whole brain. And that's the key. So these are pictures of some patients that we have with little strokes. I told you the strokes that we've been able to get people to have can be much smaller, but all of these people had problems with their cognition. They're little strokes. What's going on? So when we did their functional neuroimaging, their MEG, what we saw when we first saw them in clinic, so these are controls, your brains, hopefully, you have information traveling across your brain all the time. You're doing a task and information's traveling. Look at this in my stroke patient. The information isn't traveling in the same way. There's far fewer connections. And this person has fairly significant cognitive impairment for a tiny little stroke. But this is the average. So it didn't matter where the stroke was for any of these patients. They all had fewer connections. So no matter where that stroke was, it was disrupting the connectivity or the talk between the brain. And as they got better over 6 months, look, the controls stayed the same. Well, yeah, because they didn't have a stroke. But the stroke patients began to get more activity. They recovered. This is really important because what it says to me is, okay, we can see there's a big difference. It looks like this might be the problem. And now it makes me think, great, they're starting to recover and I see clinically they're getting better. So can I make it happen faster? Can I help improve cognition? And if so, can I use the MEG to show me that those connections are getting better if I try a treatment and see if it may be effective? This is just another, I like this image. It's just another way to see what I just showed you, where right after their stroke at the first visit, they don't have a lot of crosstalk. And that crosstalk significantly improves over time. So how do we get it better? We know these connections aren't happening. Well, that's where mindfulness comes in, which I know is what you guys were most interested in today. And the thought is, so mindfulness-based stress reduction is a practice that I'll talk about in just a second, but it exercises the brain. It gets it to work and engage. And it's actually been shown in prior studies, not with stroke, to help with concentration and attention. And hey, I told you guys, that's what my stroke patients are complaining of, right? Concentration, attention, multitasking. So the thought was, well, maybe mindfulness-based stress reduction will be able to, one, get patients better clinically, and then also show us improved connections on MEG. And what we compared it to in our study was a regular stroke support group, because especially during COVID, just being with people, right, is different. If you're sitting home alone and not doing anything versus going to mindfulness, then maybe it's just the socialization, or maybe it's something else. But so we wanted to give them a similar experience where they'd be with people, but not doing this mindfulness. So what is mindfulness-based stress reduction? Well, it's actually a practice that dates back a long time ago to ancient times, but it's really actually gaining a lot of popularity as a treatment for anxiety and depression. So it's a cross between meditation and yoga. So not quite what John was doing, but more stretching and movement, but also meditation. And so kind of a cross between headspace and yoga, I guess, for lack of a better term. More recently, it's been used in the United States to treat pain and migraine. And they even tried it in a small study of Alzheimer's, and kind of had some mixed results. So there's some data to suggest that maybe it's worth looking at in stroke patients. Well, what do we think it does? Well, I'll tell you that meditation also dates back to ancient times. And when they looked at the Buddhist monks who would spend a lot of time meditating and do a really great job, and they put EEG leads on, they saw that it changed the activity, particularly in the frontal and the temporal lobes. So meditating changed the way your brain functioned and the way your brain was wired. And the thought that we had is that maybe mindfulness, this practice of meditation and yoga, where you're training your brain and engaging your brain, may do the same thing. why did we choose mindfulness-based stress reduction as opposed to Headspace or something else like that that you can get on your phone? The reason is because it has the most data behind it. It's a program. I believe it started at Harvard, actually, but it's an 8-week program that's very guided. There's a lot of evidence and a lot of structure to it. So it was a great thing to use for research. But I'm not sure that it has to be mindfulness-based stress reduction. Something else to think about, but we wanted to start with what had the most evidence behind it so that we could look at that. So currently we have an ongoing trial. We just finished the last patient, I'm excited to report, where we took 30 patients and we randomized them to mindfulness versus stroke support group. And they met virtually for 8 weeks because we wanted it to be easy for people, right? And they either went through the intervention. And then we're also able to use an iPhone app with, again, more mindfulness practices that they could do anytime they wanted to at home versus a traditional stroke support group where people interacted and had their questions answered and were able to have support. And what we did is we imaged their brain before and after, and we did clinical testing before and after. And what we wanted to see was two things, right? One is, does it help their thinking, right, at all? Do we see difference in scores? Because that's what we want. Does it impact depression? Because that's a big part of stroke too. And I told you that there's definitely data for mindfulness and depression. So I didn't want to not look at that. But then in explaining these things, what did it look like on MEG? Does it help make the connections better, faster, right? So is there a way that we can monitor that? Because then we could take it and apply it to different groups, not just stroke. I'll tell you, I'm in the process of analyzing. I wish I had amazing data for you to share. I'll tell you that the patients in the mindfulness group have expressed quality of life that they feel like they're improving, right? But as far as the impact on their scores, I don't have all that data analyzed just yet because we just closed the study or the analysis on MEG. But I am excited to see what our findings show. Before I kind of sum up and talk about people without stroke, I want to tell you about one more exciting treatment because it also may be important for the treatment of cognition. So I told you about those connections that are not right, right? So we talked about mindfulness and how we may be able to exercise them, but neurostimulation, what does that mean? So TDCS takes a little current. It's like, you know, when you were little and you sometimes would touch your tongue to a 9-volt battery and have that little shock, less than that, but a little bit of neurostimulation that you just place on the head, right on the side of the stroke, actually has been shown to cause alterations in the brain function over an obvious pre-specified area. And what we've been able to do and are doing ongoing in parallel to our mindfulness study is to target areas of the brain where we know cognitive networks exist, cognitive networks that are important for, I put my pointer on the wrong slide, sorry. So this is the area that the stimulation is, we know affects, and these are the cognitive networks. So they're the same place. So hoping to affect the cognitive network and again, improve the focus and the concentration within those networks. So two different ways we may be able to target the network. So you're saying to me, great, I'm glad I know all there is to know about a stroke, but how does that help me? What can I think about? Well, you know, I think stroke is really special. I think it has a close place to my heart, but I don't think it's unique. And there's lots of ways that we can get brain pathology, unfortunately. So people with multiple sclerosis, people with Parkinson's disease can have little areas of the brain that are affected. And vascular dementia, when we start to get just generalized cognitive impairment, it's due to little infarcts also. So my suspicion is that the cognitive impairment we see in all of these disorders may respond the same way and may be due to this connectivity problem, and that the same potential treatments like mindfulness and neurostimulation may be helpful in these groups as well. So a lot of fun and exciting work to be done to hopefully help a lot of people. It's just the tip of the iceberg. We have a lot to do, but I'm very hopeful that we're going to make significant strides moving forward. So I want to end and then certainly take all of your questions, but just summing up. So network dysfunction, right? That talk between the brain, I really think is the key to understanding all kinds of dementia or all kinds of cognitive impairment. certainly after stroke, we've seen it, but with other types of cognitive impairment as well. So we may be able to generalize it to other disease states. And that really paves the way for things like mindfulness, things like neurostimulation to alter the network and to really exercise the brain and get those connections restored and better. I just want to recognize everybody that, you know, these are team efforts. I have multi-center collaborations with the University of Maryland, with MIT, with the University of Texas, and with, of course, my own lab has done a tremendous amount of work, and I can't thank them all enough. And with that, I want to throw it out for questions because I'd love to hear what's important to you guys. I'm going to stop sharing my screen so I can see.
Our in-person audience, Dr. Marsh, writing down questions, and the question that they have is, one of the questions is, do strokes always occur on the right side of the brain? What's the difference? Oh, what's the mechanism?
My apologies. No, I just picked two to show that that they now tend to, in some patients, we've been able to make them smaller. So that was but they can occur anywhere in the brain, the right side or the left side. It doesn't matter. We still see those same impaired connections. And that's important, right? Because what that tells us is that, like I was saying, in order to think, you need your whole brain and information traveling back and forth. So it doesn't matter where you have the stroke, where you lesion. Once you have a problem and that connection is impaired, the same result happens. And there's that same impaired connectivity and the same problems with concentration and attention happen. Great question.
So for our audience, for the audience that's in person, do you have any questions for us? If you can pass your questions along. I think that there are a couple of questions.
Sure, I can read the chat. Let's see.
You look at the chat and I'll mind this room, Dr. Marsh. How about that?
Perfect. So I see a question about thrombectomy. So yes, so what is the time window for thrombectomy? That's a great question. It keeps changing over time, the more we learn about who benefits. People infarct their brain differently. Some people infarct really quickly and others do it more slowly. So we actually have ways when you come to the hospital to figure out how much of your brain has already died, because if a big portion has already been damaged, opening up the blood vessel actually has a huge risk for bleeding. So when we think about things like thrombectomy, which is that second thing where we put the catheter in and pull out the clot, we need to weigh the risks and the benefits about how much of the brain has already died and how much is left to save. So it can be beyond the 4.5 hour window that I tell everybody about for TPA. The bottom line though is that you got to come in as fast as you can.
On that same note, Dr. Marsh, we talked about thrombectomy and you talked about, I call it the rotor-rooter for the arteries, but what about removing it from the jugular? I mean, I'm calling that, I think the person means an endarterectomy. Is that still the mainstay of treatment for strokes or? How much more advanced is what you described?
So that's a preventative strategy. So the things I described are in the acute setting when a blood vessel is clogged. Strokes can come from the carotid, like you said. And sometimes people have to have a surgery to fix that. But this is in that initial, they can also come from other places like the heart, from AFib or from other places. So the endarterectomy is a treatment. We say, oh, the person had a stroke and it must have come from their carotid artery. We want to take the plaque out, rotor-root it out. That's a great way to think about it. So that is something we do to prevent the next stroke, but these are to treat the current stroke you have. Good question.
Okay.
Can I answer? This one is my favorite, if it's okay. So sure. What is good brain exercise? So it's my favorite question because there's not a good answer, but it's really important. Anything you do with your brain is better than nothing. So I don't have the magic bullet of what's the best exercise to do. So what I tell people is to pick something that's challenging for them, but that they enjoy doing. So if you hate Sudoku puzzles and I tell you that's the best and you're never going to want to do them or hate doing it, that's not worth it. But if you love Sudoku puzzles, that's a great way to keep your brain engaged and to keep your brain healthy and active. So my principle
is pick
what you like to do that's challenging and keep doing it.
Card games like bridge?
Love it. Totally.
Okay.
Okay.
And it's great even to interacting with other people. COVID was really bad for us. Separating from everyone else, from all of our family and our friends, and not engaging and having dialogues and discussions. A lot of people had a lot of problems with their thinking, with their cognition. So it's real. We're social creatures. So that engagement piece is also really critical.
Okay. Is the neurostimulator similar to the TENS unit that's used for pain therapy?
That's a really good question. Kinda. It's nowhere near as intense. People know when they have a TENS on. Most of the time, once the little bit of stimulation occurs, you don't. Patients wear it for about a half hour or so. And we actually do studies where treatment versus sham, and they can't tell the difference because it's so light. But yes, similar, but much less.
So the question is, would smoking cause vascular strokes? I give a lot of discussion on vascular risk factors for stroke. And sometimes I think people hear what they want to hear. So can you talk about smoking as a vascular risk factor?
Yeah, so smoking is one of the best and hardest preventable risk factors for stroke. It is hard. The cigarette companies, boy, do they have us over a barrel. They did a good job. It is hard to quit, but it is one of the best things you can do to decrease your brain risk as well as your heart risk.
Okay. Smoking kind of thickens your brain and makes it more likely that you develop blood clots.
What it does is it helps to, right? We talked about that kitchen sink. That's what happens in the blood vessels. Over time, just by being older, we get more plaque. That's the gunk, right? The gunk in your sink. But smoking and diabetes and blood pressure and obesity, all of those things make that gunk build up more and more. And our goal is to keep it as low as we can, because the more it builds up, the higher the risk is for stroke.
These last two, and I know you have to go, you mentioned vascular dementia, and I think if people have paid attention, I mean, there are several different types of dementia. Are there different types of vascular dementia?
That's a great question. In general, we tend to group the vascular dementias into a single topic, that so stroke or ischemic disease causes dementia. But yes, it's what we call physicians like big long terms. We call it heterogeneous. So yes, there are many different causes of vascular dementia, but in general, it's ischemic disease. So whether it's multiple strokes or it's clogging of the vessels, anything that is due to kind of blood vessel blockage that impacts your brain falls under that category of vascular dementia.
And one question here that has to do with stress. Can you kind of talk about how stress may feed into one's risk, increasing one's risk for developing a stroke-like problem or obstruction in the blood vessels?
And let me actually talk about both, about stroke and cognitive impairment. So as far as stress and stroke, long-term stress increases pressure, increases catecholamines, and overall increases stroke risk. That does not mean that if you yell at your child or have a fight with your boss, that your stroke risk goes up immediately. But over time, long-term stress is not good for you. And we see those health effects. In cognition, though, it's the same thing. Stress, actually, we've seen in this form of depression and anxiety, worsens cognition also. So yes, learning positive ways to manage stress is incredibly important for overall brain health and thinking, as well as for stroke prevention.
Thank you. And this last one I have here is World of Warcraft. I think that's a game, right?
I think so.
I've got people in here shaking their heads. So this is above my level of interference and knowledge. What is it? Oh, it's a video game. So okay. I guess the global question is,
does it work
video
too?
Games better for us?
So I don't have good data, but again, engaging your brain is always better than doing nothing. So is it better than doing a Sudoku puzzle? I don't know. Are you more likely to do it and engage your brain than have at it, right? Maybe try to do different activities, but something is always better than nothing. And we don't have great data on what the best things are.
And on that note, if you're able to play these games, that's a good relief for you. But if somebody you know has memory problems and the difficulty with the way their brain works, trying to learn something new like that is frustrating and stressful for them. It's really for people who have the ability. Can you?
Well, that's why what I mean is picking something that is challenging but manageable. So that person that has trouble, no, it's not wonderful to say, oh, let's play this card game that you never know how to do and hate it every single time. No, pick something that's challenging but manageable for them to do, right? That engages their brain at that level. So, and that's what I mean about personalizing it. That's a wonderful point. Thank you for bringing that up.
Thank you so much, Dr. Marsh. I know you have to go, but we have really, really, really enjoyed you. And we've had over 250 people on this call. And if we're really good, we're going to have you back in person. So
thank you so much, Dr. Marsh. I'd love it. I told my residents today on service that I was flying to Emory. And I said, no, I'm just Zooming in. But I'd love to be there. Thank you so much. It was really a pleasure.
Thank you for making it easy.
Have a great day.
How many in this room are over the age of 80? This is for the people who are over 80. Oh, there's one. There's two. And it just so happens that they're both gentlemen. Okay, so Mr. Binford is one of our more senior coordinators. And that's right. You may know somebody. So Mr. Binford is going to talk to you about our SuperAger studies. We have two. There are some requirements, but if you know somebody who's 80 and above, we'd like to hear from you. Mr. Bill can put you on a list.
Here, Bill. You want this?
Yeah, that'll be good. Hey, guys. I just want to take about 5 minutes of your time and make a pitch for this new study we're doing at Emory. It's called the SuperAger study. We've been doing it about 3 months. We just have a few participants. This is your chance to get in on the ground floor. It's very exciting research. This research has been done in Chicago at Northwestern University for about, well, going on 10 years. And the principal investigator up there, Emily Rogowski, has made some amazing discoveries. SuperAgers, she defines, are people who are 80 and up, who perform on memory tests like 50 or 60 year olds, people that are 20 to 30 years their junior. Great memories, very active people. And she's made some interesting discoveries by doing MRIs on their brains. She's found that their cerebral cortex does not shrink, does not atrophy at the same rate as other less cognitively gifted 80 and 90 year olds. So their brain stays healthier. It looks more like a 50 or 60 year old brain. And because many of the SuperAgers have generously decided to donate their brains at the time of death, they've been able to do some microscopic research on the brains too. And they found some interesting things. There's a particular type of neuron they found in one part of the brain called the anterior cingulate. And these neurons, called von Economo neurons, are very important in attention, paying attention, being focused. And the SuperAgers, it turns out, have four times as many of these neurons as their less gifted peers. So to be a SuperAger, all you got to do is come over to the Alzheimer's Disease Research Center over there and do some cognitive testing. You'll do a blood draw, you'll do an MRI, and you'll come back every 2 years and do the same thing over again. Are there any questions about SuperAgers? Yes, ma'am. I would love to, yeah. The question is, what if they're 79? What if these guys are 79? I would love to talk to 78 or 79-year-olds, put you on my waiting list, and then I'll follow you for a couple of years. When you have your 80th birthday, we'll get you into the program. All right. I'm sorry?
That count?
Well, as soon as they turn 80, we'll get them right into the program. Yes, ma'am. What I would like you to do, if you don't mind, ma'am, is grab one of these flyers on your way out the door and give it to that almost 80-year-old, okay? These flyers have my information on the back of one of the pages. So grab one, give me a call, we'll get you signed up. Yes, ma'am, did you have a question?
Spinal tap also required?
Question is there a spinal tap required? Actually, kind of. To be in the SuperAger study, we are going to require people to co-enroll in the memory study, memory at Emory study. To be in that study, you do a spinal tap, a lumbar puncture every 2 years. Okay, so you would be required to do one to be in that study. There is not another lumbar puncture specifically for the SuperAger study. Does that answer your question? Are there any other questions? Yes, sir.
In this program, and if we're already in the brain study, every 2 years, we get the MRI and the...
I understand. I guess the question is, why would you need to go into the memory study if you're already in the healthy brain study? The reason is the research team has made the decision that because many of the measures done in the memory study are identical to the measures done in the SuperAger study, we are allowed to reuse that data up to a certain point. If we can bring a person in within 90 days of their memory study, we can reuse all that data and we don't have to bore you by putting you through all those tests again for a couple of hours. Does that answer your question, sir? Are there any other questions? All right, guys, thank you. Please, yes, ma'am.
How long will it go on?
It's longitudinal. It will go on as long as you're willing and able to participate.
Okay, so on that note, and this is a really good question. One of the things that we're trying to do in our research center is develop better mechanisms for helping us with and without cognitive impairment stay in tune. So for people who are being seen by our neurology clinic and or our research participants and have been given a diagnosis of what we call mild cognitive impairment, which means you're functional, except that sometimes you just have some difficulties processing things, but you're still highly independent and functional, you might be a candidate for our cognitive empowerment program, which is only available to people who are clinical patients being followed here in the Emory Cognitive Neurology Department or our research participants who've been given a diagnosis of mild cognitive impairment. As things progress, we're partnering with Georgia Tech to refine and work on those things that help our memories to stay healthy with or without impairment. So part of the collaboration that the Goizueta Alzheimer's Disease Research Center has here in Atlanta in the state of Georgia is we partner with other research institutions. So right here in Georgia, we do partner with Georgia Tech. And Georgia Tech works very closely with us as we develop and refine techniques for maintaining and improving cognitive function. You might have heard of something called eye tracking or the flickering light test, which is being piloted and refined here at Georgia Tech. Well, we're doing that through our cognitive empowerment program. And if you're one of our research volunteers, I'm not going to say participants because you are all volunteers. This is not a substitute for good medical care. But if you're in one of our programs and something else comes along, we get funded to do something else, it's good to be on the in crowd. You know, this is a really exclusive group I'm inviting you to join. I'm saying it that way simply because we're going to help you. Someplace else may not be accountable, but we're pretty accountable people, don't you think? Yes. We try to make sure you have a good time. We try to make sure that we speak in terms that you understand. And we spoil you a little bit trying to make sure that you're comfortable, right? So we want you to keep coming. So we're going to keep doing what we do. And we want you to volunteer for something because we may not have all the studies that are in the clinicaltrials.gov here, but what we do have, we're willing to share and have you share with other people because we want everybody to live as well as they can, for as long as they can, as independently as they can, because we don't want our children telling us what to do, right? I see. Amen to that. This isn't church, but that's it. Ms. Cornelya?
Let Megan talk and then we'll do two more things. People want to know about the
Okay. Megan, say what you have to say, because I got something else to share.
Thank you, Dr. Parker. I'm coming on from Emory's Cognitive Empowerment Program to invite you guys to join our webinar that we have right after Brain Talk Live. And, you know, just like Dr. Parker said, you know, come get the information that you need for your brain health. We always talk about different physical activities, new technologies, all different ways to age in place and stay active. And I'm going to drop a link into the chat for anyone who's at home online and wants to join right here at 3 o'clock. Today, one of our researchers is sharing a lot of her findings from participants in the Cognitive Empowerment Program related to different sleep habits, daily mood habits of people with MCI and their care partners. So I'm just going to share that in the link right here, and I'll turn it over right back to you, Dr. Parker.
Thank you, Megan. That's a cognitive empowerment program we talked to you about. So Mrs. Dorbin, who is co-director of our Outreach Recruitment and Education Corps and our Minority Engagement Corps, wants to let you know about some upcoming conferences that our Alzheimer's Disease Research Center is very integral to in terms of planning, orchestrating, and carrying out. There are a couple of programs that we would like you as the general public to come to if you are amenable to it. Cornelya?
Okay, so if you're on site or virtual, we have a couple of announcements. You saw the scrolling slides, but when I send out the email, there's a ton of information in it. You gotta click through those links, okay? But the Brain Health Forum, if you wanna register, that registration is already up, okay? And it's on Eventbrite. So if you registered for this program on Eventbrite live for our in-person audience, go to Eventbrite. I can't breathe. Okay. Go to Eventbrite, and that's how you can register for the Carter Center. It's our 24th forum. So you know, if you've been there before, it's a great opportunity to learn, connect, and we won't be feeding you. We're just going to send you home with the gift card to feed yourself, but we will have some refreshments. All right. If you are live, take a flyer. If you are benefiting, the best thing you can do is share this with someone else. We don't want to keep this to ourselves. What we hear all the time is, why didn't anyone tell me? Why didn't my doctor know? Well, you're informed. So now, you know, you can take a flyer, share it with your neighbor, your colleagues, your friends, whomever. Okay, I'm going to post the link for the next live Brain Talk Live hybrid tomorrow. So when you see that email, we're going with first come, first serve. And this room can easily hold 75. I think we have nearly 40. That's great. We can manage 75. So if you know you want to come, go ahead and register. If you know you can't, give that spot up to someone else. I feel bad when I have to tell people no. But we know life happens, things happen all the time, things come up, you have the best intentions of coming and you can't, that's okay, just let us know and we can open up that spot for someone else who wants to be here with us in person, okay? We have another program coming up next Thursday. It's our monthly minority men's health program. If you're not a male, you're not a minority, you surely know someone. This is the same level of engagement, but for minority men, which is the most underrepresented group in our research cohort. And we are being very concerted and intentional in keeping them informed and aware. And so the best way that we do that is we bring them on site once a month and share health information with them. Dr. Williams will be our featured speaker along with Dr. Parker next Thursday. That's on Eventbrite too. So we use Eventbrite and it's worked well for us to get information out there. But if you know an underrepresented male that's an adult that could possibly benefit from our research, we want them to join us and be on site with us. All right. That's all I have. Thank you to our virtual audience. There's lots of links that have been dropped. So grab those links. You know, the recording will be posted. It takes a little time, guys, to get the recording out. But there's over 100 videos on our YouTube channel. So you too can become an expert in brain health just by taking, you know, this time out of your week each week, but also throughout the week to look at any of the recordings All right. So thank you to our staff, our faculty, our partners, and each of you.